The Churchville Schoolhouse opens the door to the best education in history. Visitors to the Churchville Schoolhouse take a step back in time to watch history unfold in a restored National Register of Historic Places property that dates to the Civil War era. Students of today walk in the footsteps of local farm children from the early days of DuPage County for an authentic living history experience led by a schoolmarm of the early 1900s. A visit to the Churchville Schoolhouse is hands-on, educational, and fun. Participants use slate chalkboards and McGuffey readers for the day's lessons, and children will be asked to follow proper classroom etiquette. Reading, writing, and arithmetic are practiced, and students test their skills during an old-fashioned spelling bee. And of course, no school day is complete without recess featuring games of the early 1900s. The schoolhouse is a popular place for scouts and day camps, too. Group visits can also be arranged for service clubs, tour groups, and other adult organizations. The Churchville Schoolhouse Living History Program is operated by the Elmhurst Historical Museum. Call the museum today to book a field trip or find out more information. Call 630-833-1457 or visit our website at churchvilleschoolhouse.org. The Churchville Schoolhouse is waiting to open the doors for your school or community group. Plan a memorable learning experience today for the best education in history.
Welcome to Elmhurst Time Travelers. We're here in the Churchville one-room schoolhouse. I'm Ken Bartels, your host, and today we're going to be talking about a rather interesting year in the history of Elmhurst and the region, that is 1871 and a few years on either side of it. And to do that today, I have a special guest, Melitta Cutright, author of both of the editions of the Elmhurst College History An Ever-Widening Circle. And Melitta, welcome to Elmhurst Time Travelers.
Thank you.
1871, we're 6 years past the end of the Civil War. We're 6 years past President Lincoln's assassination. The country still reeling. Elmhurst was probably still reeling as well. In fact, it wasn't Elmhurst. No. Or had, 1869, it had become Elmhurst instead of Cottage Hill. But what's going on in Elmhurst in 1871?
Well, Elmhurst was a very interesting and very diverse town in 1871. There were really two parts of Elmhurst. There was the area north of the tracks, which was inhabited largely by German immigrants or the second, third generations of German immigrants. Many of them came from the Mid-Atlantic states. On the south, there was a lot of still open land, but there were also a number of summer houses, mansions. The wealthy people in Chicago had discovered that you could get out to DuPage County, you could get to Elmhurst, Cottage Hill, and you could get fresh air, it was cooler, and so they built their summer homes here. Some very famous ones. One of the things I found particularly interesting was as early as that, you had businessmen who commuted every day downtown. They would have their carriage take them to the train station. They took the Chicago and Northwestern. They went downtown. They were picked up at the other end, did their business, came on back up again. Sounds very modern, doesn't it? But it was in 1871.
I think, too, the makeup of the city, as you said, ethnically diversified, I think there was also the backlash of the end of the Civil War was things were coming back. Things were starting to be not so much rebuilt as rethought. And there was migration on people's minds. As the country was dealing with the aftermath of the Civil War and still reeling from the first presidential assassination, we were in Elmhurst dealing with our own ramifications from that. Lincoln obviously having been elected from Illinois.
Well, and you were seeing a number of people starting to move out. It wasn't too much earlier that they were pushed the Potawatomi out. They were in this area until about the 1830s. And then slowly the people moved in, farmers, and then the German immigrants, artisans on the north side, and then this group of very wealthy business people who had their summer homes. There was also a sanatorium out here, which had all kinds of cures. And this was a place people came for vacation. It was a very healthful place, and people wanted to come out here for picnics and all the rest of that.
And of course, today, it's kind of counterintuitive to think about opening. I mean, oftentimes, we now think about escaping to the lake in the summer.
Yeah.
Whereas they were escaping from not so much the lake as from the environment that still existed at that point in time in the city of Chicago. Of course, the city of Chicago at that point, almost entirely wooden structures, as almost everything was in the day. So in early October, October 8th and extending into October 10, the city of Chicago is ablaze, the Great Chicago Fire. And however you think about the attributes or of what the how the fire came to be, it was a devastating situation for 300 people died, which is significant enough, but significant portion of the city of Chicago as it existed at that time essentially went up in flames.
Blocks after blocks after blocks. And apparently it was very windy because it went fast. Because you'll read people talking about, they saw the fire, it was coming, they started to get out, they tried to put some things, and it was just on them. And it just kept going north and east, and some people took shelter in the lake.
I rarely do this on Time Travelers, but I have an article here that was reprinted in the Elmhurst Press in early October of 1971, obviously the centennial year. And I'm just going to very quickly read a couple of sections of this. Between the early evening of Sunday, October 8, and the early morning of Tuesday, October 10, fire destroyed nearly every building in an area 3 1/3 square miles in the heart of Chicago. Property valued at $200 million at that point in time, 300 were killed. From the ruined city, a lot of the folks, as you indicated, who could, left, got out as quickly as they could. Mrs. Aurelia Case King was among those driven from their homes. She was with the family of Henry King. They lived at that point on Rush Street near Erie Street. And then their Elmhurst home was at the corner of St. Charles Road and Cottage Hill. This is a quote from Mrs. King. "We had just moved to the city and had settled ourselves for the winter. We were never so comfortably situated as we were at that point in time. We were on the high tide of prosperity. At 1 o'clock in the morning, she and her family were awakened by shouts of people in the streets declaring the city was on fire. We just had time to dress, tie up a few valuables in sheets and stuff them into our carriage, and we had to deliberately leave our home and run for our lives. It was 2 o'clock in the morning when I fled with my little children clinging to me, literally in a shower of fire. They found a conveyance at about noon on Monday, which brought them out to Elmhurst. And the Kings reached their summer home at 6 o'clock on Monday. And at that point in time, you know, were for all practical purposes residents of Elmhurst. She also talks about who else was impacted. And we're going to talk more about some of these names, but Thomas Barber Bryant, boarded some folks. He had a summer home in Elmhurst called Bird's Nest, which we'll also reference again in a few minutes. But he had lost property in the city, Bryant Hall, which was on Clark Street in the city. And it, Bryant Hall was the chief center of musical and theatrical activities in the city of Chicago. And of course, it was completely destroyed. And also destroyed in the fire, we're going back to the Lincoln connection, also destroyed in the fire, or was an original copy of the Emancipation Proclamation that Bryan had purchased.
Yes.
Bryan was a friend of President Lincoln's. It's hard to even imagine a fire of that magnitude and the devastation that it wrought, not only in the city where it took place, but then the impact it had on the region.
They say that Elmhurst was bursting at the seams because Bryant might have had not only his family, but he had his servants from downtown. He had friends. They said that even their dressmakers and bootmakers came out here. Where else are they going to go? So they went to the people they knew. So Elmhurst was in that weekend was changed considerably. And many of them went back, but some of them didn't.
Well, we're going to talk about Elmhurst's role in the organizational rebuilding of Chicago. But there's another gentleman comes into the play about this time. Actually, he'd been in Elmhurst much longer than that. But Seth Wadhams, who was the, if you will, founder and of what now we know as Wilder Park, White Birches, which we now know as the Wilder Mansion. He had, of course, interests in Chicago, even though he had large interests out here as well. And he took, the story goes, he takes his, after the fire, he takes his buckboard and wagon and goes into the city of Chicago and the city courthouse, which was adorned with a number of ornamental urns on the top of it, which were now essentially on the ground and available for folks to, He took two of those, brought them back to Elmhurst, and they were on his property in what now is Wilder Park for many, many years. And one of them, of course, is still there, just outside of the conservatory. In fact, we featured it in a Time Travelers program a few months ago. And we also did a program principally devoted to Wilder Park. But it was not uncommon at that time for folks to visit the devastated city and salvage what they could wherever they could salvage it.
I think that's probably common whenever there's a fire, for better or for worse.
In fact, I read it in doing some research for the program. I read an interesting story that talked about the fact that for decades afterwards, what passed for what we now call flea markets always featured something from the fire, whether it was plates that were fused together by the heat or some piece of metal or an ornamentation or something that miraculously just survived. There were always artifacts from the fire.
Whether in Chicago or when there's a great London fire or anything, always there are people who profit, if you're going to call it that, from the fire. And there would have been lots of bits and pieces that were being picked over.
Now, once again, we'll talk a little bit more about Elmhurst's role in the rebuilding or planning for the rebuilding of Chicago. But 1871 has interesting for Elmhurst in a very formal way. Mm-hmm. Of course, that is that in 1871 is the date that's associated with the founding of what we now know as Elmhurst College. Mm-hmm. So from your book, I'll let you recount the 1871 story of Professor Inspector Kranz. Yes. And the 14 young boys.
Well, it was just about 2 months later, on December 6th, 1871, that Karl Kranz and 14 young, well, they weren't all young, yeah, 14 young men got off the train at Evanston, at Elmhurst, and they were going to start a pro-seminary or pre-seminary of the German Evangelical Church. They'd come from Evansville, where they had been for a couple of years, but the German Evangelical Church had bought 20 acres of land in Elmhurst from Thomas Barber Bryan, 20 acres for $10,000. And then he and his wife Jane gave them 10 acres in addition. So they had 30 acres of land, which has become really the center of Elmhurst College. They've added some land otherwise, but that's the center. And on that land was what was described as a substantial farmer's house. Well, I think it was a little bit bigger than that. It was known as the Melanchthon Seminary because there'd been a seminary there. And they were supposed to move into that house as soon as they got off the train. But the train car with their furniture and possessions didn't come. So the parishioners at Emmanuel Church in Churchville took them for the holidays, and they stayed up here with them until their furniture came and they could move into what became the school. And so it's kind of appropriate for us to be right in Churchville.
Right. Well, and of course, when you think about it, you know, we're 2 months, less than 2 months, or from the fire. And the railway system had to be impacted. They're already, you're doing all the salvaging in the city, you're cleaning up, you're getting ready to rebuild in whatever form that's going to take, and they don't really know at that point. And the rail system is obviously not operating normal either. So Inspector Kranz and the students, their car goes awry, and it's not like it is today where they pretty much know where everything is all the time. It was had to be found and rerouted, and that took a little while.
Well, you didn't just go to the nearby motel to stay either. So they were lucky that the people took them. Talking about the rebuilding, and once the fire was cooling, Chicago decided to rebuild immediately. Right. There was no question they were going to rebuild. They were going to rebuild there. How they were going to rebuild, they weren't sure. But it didn't take any time to decide they were going to rebuild.
All right, that brings us to our break. We're going to take a short break, and Melitta, and we'll come right back. Okay. This is Elmhurst Time Travelers. We're talking about 1871.
Visit Elmhurst.org to explore the new City of Elmhurst website. Find out the latest Elmhurst news, pay utility bills and parking tickets, report concerns, and much more. Elmhurst.org is an ideal way to discover what Elmhurst offers your business, your family, your life.
Welcome back to Elmhurst Time Travelers. I'm Ken Bartels, and we're talking to author Melitta Cutright about 1871 and what was going on in Elmhurst and the region. We just got done talking about, Melitta, the Great Chicago Fire, and obviously that'll come back in the course of conversation. But as you mentioned just before we went to break, Chicago decided immediately to rebuild. It wasn't woe is us as much as it is what are we going to do now, how's that going to work? A lot of that planning took place where those folks were living now. You know, and in some and in many cases, that was Elmhurst and its role, Elmhurst's role in the rebuilding, or at least the planning for the rebuilding of Chicago. Thomas Barber Bryan played a very large role in that. As you know, he had run for mayor of the city of Chicago a couple of times. Obviously, he was a very important businessman, not only in Chicago, but in the region. And Bird's Nest, which was his home in Elmhurst, became kind of an epicenter for rebuilding Chicago and the planning thereof. What else do we know about Bryan?
Well, we know that his house had seven bedrooms and closets, which is extremely unusual. And it had a bathroom and a gymnasium and so forth. But he graduated from Harvard, both as an undergraduate and law school. He was a important in the legal parts of Chicago, real estate, and as you said, politically. So where he was, power was. And while they were planning the rebuilding, in Elmhurst they also had something else. They had a lot of labor, because the north side of Elmhurst was filled with a lot of German artisans who helped rebuild Chicago. So it was not only planned, but a lot of the work for decades was coming from the people who lived on the north side of Chicago, of Elmhurst.
Well, and as you had mentioned, it was, you know, the train line still actively already in place and had arrived in the 1840s. Mm-hmm. And so there was
transportation.
There was a means of getting the workers there. He also raised a great deal of money for the rebuilding and organized much of it. But he obviously had a vested interest in rebuilding what was his home city and a city that was very clearly now embarking on an entirely new chapter in its existence.
Didn't have to rebuild with wood, which was one of the things that happened. They got to redo it, and kind of got to redo it again. And he had been a cultural leader in Chicago too, lots with music and things. Interestingly, in Bird's Nest, he had a major library. After he died, his family gave 2,500 volumes of his library to what was at that time Elmhurst College, to start the first library at Elmhurst College.
Now, it's always been interesting to me since I started to learn about Elmhurst history and first introduced to Thomas Bryan, that, you know, we've got Bryan Junior High, which it seems like half the people in town call it Bryant Junior High, but it's Bryan Junior High. It's named after Thomas Barber Bryan, and yet I don't know of any other significant remembrances, if you will, of what is generally called in some of the history realms, you know, the father of Elmhurst. I mean, he's referred to that. I saw that reference several times in doing research. Just seems a little odd that we've kind of not picked up on that very well.
That one, but the really, other than Gloss Mansion and some of the mausoleum, Elmhurst doesn't seem to memorialize many of its founders.
Got another short little excerpt here. This is a document created as part of the DuPage County history. It's written by Margaret Pruder, who is currently serving on the Elmhurst Heritage Foundation board, but she writes that the golden age of Elmhurst was in the 1870s. And she writes about the fact that elaborate balls at the estates of the period, Hagen's Hawthorne, and that's the other thing. Everybody named their homes and houses. Lucian Hagen's Hawthorne, Fred Rockwood's Hollywood, George Runze's Sweetbriar, later owned by Frank Sturgis, Lee Sturgis Shadeland, which still is in place, John Case's Orchard House. It's just a fascinating time. All, as you mentioned, all of these people repurposed, displaced. Now, they had places to go, obviously, but it sounds like the town was really hopping at that point.
Well, it's interesting to think about, you know, all the carriages and all the dressmakers and all that, rubbing shoulders with the artisans, the German artisans, and you would do that in town. While there were a lot of the wealthy here, Elmhurst still continued to be a heavily German town. German was spoken in the stores. Bryant made speeches in German and English. It's said that you heard as much German as English on the streets of Elmhurst and in the stores, post office and things, until about World War I. So you have this two totally different groups who didn't kind of rub together along the edges, and they were valuable to each other.
Yeah, they had purpose. Mm-hmm. Both groups had purpose, and in some cases, the rebuilding
same of, purpose.
You know, united those purpose. The book I was referencing, by the way, is called DuPage Roots, and it's also completely online at the DuPage County Historical Museum site. But Bryant bought 1,000 acres originally from the Bateses, and we know about the Bateses and the Glosses and their involvements in town almost from the beginning. Built Bird's Nest at the corner of southwest corner of St. Charles Road and York Street. At that point in time, there were about 200 people in the community is all, but
about 300 when the in 1871.
300 when they moved along. So yeah. He had an amazing influence. And as I said, a friend of Lincoln's. I read somewhere that he was one of the pallbearers at his funeral. Yeah. Now that's, as I understand, is a little misleading because I guess there were
everywhere you went.
everywhere Lincoln's train went.
Yeah.
There were, each community had their own set of pallbearers, or that's as I understand it. But let's shift gears just a little bit and talk about Elmhurst as the eastern entrance into DuPage County, which was true then, it's true now. What do you think the lasting influence of the movement of these folks west meant to the community and its development?
One of the things that I don't know is how many of those people stayed.
Right.
We know that some of them did, but others have went back. But it certainly made Elmhurst more known, and it made it more, people in Chicago were much more aware of what Elmhurst was. As all these people were moving west, whether they stayed or whether they went back, because they still came back for the summers. So I think all of that, if you can use the modern term, publicized Elmhurst, and then there was just this feeling that there's land out there. There was still land. There was empty land. It was pretty flat, and until the Bryan and people started planting the trees, it was a match in the way of trees, but you could still come out here and you could find land, and you could build a house, and people wanted to come.
Well, and part two of the relocation, of course, is that Elmhurst, which became an economic center and a financial center for what was still, obviously, as you said, a pretty empty area. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that was due to the fact that the banks had burned down too.
Yes.
And so in order to conduct business, including the business of rebuilding Chicago, it had to be transacted here. And then that started to build organizations and businesses, some of which exist to this very day. Elmer's Chicago Stone Company, which certainly had a role in the rebuilding, because as you said, they didn't have to rebuild, or decided and didn't to rebuild with wood. So it was, you know, an economic, it became a bigger economic and cultural center than it probably maybe ever would have, except for the fire.
And it always had the train.
Right.
That's what linked it at that time to Chicago. You, I mean, you had plank roads that were muddy and all the rest of it, but you could get around on the train.
Well, back to the, we'll go back to the college just for a second. So the belongings arrive for Inspector Kranz and his gang. And of course, then a relatively short period of time later, 1878, Old Main is constructed.
That was the second of the buildings. The first one was in 1873. There were 14 people came, and 10 were waiting for them here. They moved into the Melancon Seminary building, which was a substantial farmhouse, but it still was pretty small for 24 people, plus his family.
Right.
The family was on the second floor. The rooms were on the first floor, along with the kitchen and the dining room. The students slept in the attic. And it was an old building. We are lucky that we have a number of early students who left their recollections. They talk about the snow sifting down through the roof. It was so crowded that they had to put their trunk at the foot of their bed, climb up, and then one of them said, insert himself into the covers as though he was putting his foot into a boot. Doesn't that paint a beautiful picture to you?
Yes, it does.
There was a stove, but it was very, very cold in the winter, and a little window, and it was hotter than heck in the summertime. So they very quickly built Kranz Hall because they needed the room. And then Main, we referred to Old Main, came just a few years there later.
And of course, it was a working farm. They grew their own. They grew their own food, which was obviously not unusual at that point in time.
Well, and the students worked. In the early days, they did pretty much all the work. It was not an easy life to be a student in 1871 or 1875. You went to classes all day. You had your chores. Class started at 5:30 in the morning. You had breakfast. You had your religious service. You had classes, or study. And they weren't classes like what we're talking about. What people did at that time was they read textbooks, and then they recited from memory to their professor. So you would be sitting in a room with a whole bunch of other young men who would be sitting on long benches, and this, you know, one would be reciting while you were trying to either study or, they said, play checkers or sometimes sleep. And you did that all day, have maybe an hour off, and then you had to go work outside. But that was probably much preferable than spending inside all the time.
Melinda, thank you for coming and sharing what you know about 1871, which is a significant amount. Your Elmhurst College histories are of great benefit, not only for the history of the college for which they were written, but I know you organized it so that each chapter along the way also identifies what's going on in the community. So I would recommend folks who enjoy this program pick up this book, because yes, it's mostly about Elmhurst College, but there are some wonderful factoids in there about the community at large. So thank you for
Thank you, enjoyed it.
This has been Elmhurst Time Travelers. I'm Ken Bartels, and from the Churchville One Room Schoolhouse, we'll see you again. Thank you.
The Elmhurst Historical Museum, located in downtown Elmhurst, is proud to present award-winning exhibits for visitors of all ages. Our adult Tea Time Talk series, family programs, and special events make learning about history interesting and fun. Admission is free, and on-site parking is available. Visit the Elmhurst Historical Museum soon. Call us today, or go to our website for the latest program details.